Hi, everyone, and welcome to The Neil Haley Show. The Neil Haley Show is heard all over the world on television and radio, and we interview celebrities, authors, educators, businesses, and brands, either in Bethel Park's TV studios or on location all over the world, on the radio and on the phone. So check it out and enjoy the show today. Hi, everyone, and welcome to The Neil Haley Show. You can check me out on Twitter at TotalTutor and NeilHaley.com. Television, radio, that's always going to be the fun thing unless I am in studio guests. But again, we're putting out our whole episodes for the entire week of awesome broadcasting. So I'm first excited to welcome the program my co-host, Peter Alvich. Peter, we got to go to Hollywood and celebrity now, right? We've done everything. In this process, from educators, we have to fit everything in that's part of the Neil Haley Show, right, Peter?
Yeah, true that. I'm looking forward to it.
All right, so I do have my guest on the line. She is going to be in Rogue Warrior, Robot Fighter, Sony's Pictures. I'm excited to welcome the program, Tracy Birdsall. Tracy, thanks for calling. How are you?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely, Tracy. Now, it's interesting looking at your bio. You did some acting, you did some modeling, then we're going to get right into the film. But some of the experience you've had have been quite interesting, haven't they, in your career in entertainment?
You know, it's been a journey, that's for sure.
A journey, but I saw some of the experiences you've been on, and it's got to be exciting where it's going now, right? You kind of were doing some modeling and then some commercials, and then did you get out of the acting business for a little bit and then came back? Explain that story a little bit to us.
Well, no, actually, you know, you have to pay the bills. And so when you're between jobs and stuff like that, you have to do that which you're asked to do. I mean, sometimes you do jobs because they're your passion and you get to create these deep characters. And sometimes you do things because, you know, you have to put food on the table and, you know, there's gaps between things when you're, you know, when acting is your career. I've been doing it since I was in my teen years, was when I joined the union. But, you know, every actor out there, we all have our success points and we all have our lulls, you know.
What would you say, Tracy, now where things are really going well for you? What did you do differently, you think, than is it just going and working and working and working and waiting for those opportunities to come?
It's not. There's no such thing as waiting. it actually has to do with training and experience and things like that. And I've studied every method out there, right? I mean, years of this and years of that. I worked with a coach named Margie Haber, you know, 5-6 years ago. And Margie was just kind of the turning point in my life where I started just really living my characters. And I've literally been working ever since then. I haven't auditioned since then. I have projects sent to me. It is more difficult. You know, it takes a toll on you. It's emotionally draining and physically draining and everything else. But it's so much fun and it's so exciting. So I think that anytime that, you know, people that are in our industry do have lulls, you need to stop and look at yourself and say, okay, what do I need to do? You need to constantly be training. You need to be constantly having life experiences.
Yes.
And constantly studying people and characters. And, you know, I think I work 100 times more than most people in my industry. I just really, really, really develop my characters and you know, really, really learn my lines long before I develop my characters so that when the character's talking, it's really the character that's talking. It's not me trying to remember anything. It just kind of comes naturally at that point. And so I think that's the difference.
All right, let's talk about Rogue Warrior, Robot Fighter, and talk to us about the film and your character.
Sure. It's a science fiction film, which is my favorite genre.
Yes.
And we actually have opening night tonight, and I'm in Los Angeles. And it's a science fiction film that depicts the you know, it's in the distant future. It depicts the overthrow of humanity by artificial intelligence on multiple worlds, not just Earth. So there's a lot of traveling. There's a lot of, you know, and it's really about finding that weapon that will end the overtake of humanity. And it's a very physical movie. It's very action, but it's also very character driven science fiction, which we don't see a lot of. So it's kind of a heavy drama set inside of self-discovery set inside of an action-based science fiction film.
Interesting. Peter, question for Tracy.
Yeah, well, I guess this is a little bit of I used to be a movie reviewer here in the state of Minnesota, and I was a blind movie reviewer here. So I've just been interested in all sorts of different movies, you know, even before that, so I've always been a movie person, but this is probably a little bit of that coming out of me, but I'm just generally curious from a viewer standpoint, is I've kind of, you know, I've heard this, the kind of the premise of the story before, you know, like humanity gets taken over by AI. Like, what is, like, what are some things that are, like, basically taking the new movie and kind of breaking the mold, so to speak, of previous predecessors to your movie?
You know, to start off from a character standpoint, you know, because people are always like, oh, comparing, you know, my character to this, you know, action, science fiction person in that one. I tried to create somebody new, somebody different, somebody that wasn't really based upon any of those other things. She's, you know, and so I think that's one of the things that initially sets it up differently, is I didn't try to be like anybody else. I tried to make the character stand out on its own. And, you know, when we're dealing in a world right now where everybody walks with a cell phone in front of their face and, we're learning to trust AI.
Right.
And the difference is this isn't just robots. You know, it's actually artificial intelligence that permeates not just mankind, but even I'd call it a mutation of mankind and artificial intelligence. And so much of this film is practical. There's very little green screen in it. And that's so that you can get lost in that journey and lost in that world. And I think it's very different than anything out there. I think it's something that people will compare other films to just because it is different.
You really had to continue to train yourself for the action scenes in this film. Is that correct, Tracy?
Oh my gosh. it was actually brutal physical activity. And I didn't really anticipate it because, you know, I'm an actress, but I hadn't done action before. But I was a tomboy growing up, and I am a bit of a gym rat, so I felt like I was prepared for it. And I'll tell you a silly mistake that I made, and that is I'm used to, you know, doing scenes over and over and over for the angles and the aerials and this, that, and everything. It never once occurred to me that I was going to have to run down those few hundred-foot sand dunes 10 times in a row. It never occurred to me. I just thought, oh, coverage, da-da-da-da-da. I'm used to doing it in the, you know, in the talkie scenes and stuff like that, but that was brutal, you know, and it's like the injuries, like when you see the character get injured, I just brought my injuries to work with me. What are you going to do? You know, just my character is just a little more worn down in some days than others, and that's, you know, that's real. And, you know, there was many, many days where there was bloodshed on this thing, and it's, you know, it just happened. And I was, like scenes like, you know, you're running down these mountains and you're having these brutal battles. And, you know, there was this one time when I got 15 feet down the hill and I'm sponsored by New Rock, so I have these big chunky boots with heels on. And I fall down at this particular point and I get down to the bottom and the director's shaking his head. He's like, no, 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 no. He's like, you fell down. Like maybe, you know, 50 feet too soon. I'm like, I fell. Like, I decided to just continue on with the scene because you can't exactly stop and walk back up and, you know, but and so those were the things I didn't take into consideration, but it pushed me physically to an extreme that I wasn't used to being pushed to. And I have to say I enjoyed it.
That's fantastic. And do you expect to do more sci-fi movies after this, especially with the feedback we're getting
actually,
so far?
We did another one.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, absolutely. We have the Time Wars in post right now, and that's actually Adolf Hitler traveling through time in order to rewrite history.
Wow.
My character had, it's really dark, actually. but I like that. You know, I like drama in science fiction. I think that it's really interesting because I grew up watching Star Trek and Star Wars and Logan's Run and all these other things, and I love that genre, but to be able to bring deep storylines and develop deep characters in it, I just think that's a fantastic place to play.
And Tracy, I think you love the love, oh, go, Peter. I'm sorry. Go.
Oh, sorry.
That's okay.
I was just thinking is I'm always interested in like learning characters wise and learning about the stories. For the movie, because you know it's humans versus AI. How did you guys kind of designate what I guess human reactions were versus you know like what reactions the AI would have? Like, I mean, did the AI actively talk, or was it more so kind of a visual, like what they do kind of thing, says what they're, you know, what they are doing or action? If that makes any sense.
I think so. You don't always, in film, in this particular film, you don't always designate or know artificial intelligence from the humans at a certain point. And so the only thing that I could do as an actress was, even when I'm dealing opposite something that's, you know, not actually a physical being, is I make it as real to me as possible. Because if I'm not buying it, you're not buying it watching it. And so there's actually, I have a sidekick in the film that is actually a little round robot. You might have seen him in the poster and the trailers. And he's still sitting next to me in my office, but I brought him in here and put him on a stand for months before we started shooting. And I would, like, talk to him, and I'd make people greet him when he came in and out. And it was just one of those things where he had to be real to me, you know. And he is real to me now when I look at him. And when I'm talking to him, I feel like he's real. And I think that's one of the things that really comes across in the film.
You're definitely doing that for sure, Tracy. Best place we can find information on you. Good luck tonight with the premiere. And I know it's going to be available very soon, June 6th in Walmart and stuff like that. But where can we find information on the film and yourself, Tracy? Where can we go?
Okay, yeah, it's actually June 6th in Walmart exclusively for 60 days, and then it goes wide. I think you can pre-order it on Amazon for August. You can go to TracyBirdsell.com. You can catch me on Twitter at TracyBirdsell1, Instagram TracyBirdsell1, and Facebook TracyBirdsellOfficial.
Well, best of luck when your next film comes out. We'll keep talking and chatting about it. So thanks for taking the time today.
Of course. Thanks for having me, and have a great day.
Take care, Tracy. Okay, bye-bye. You're listening to The Neil Haley Show and watching The Neil Haley Show, and we'll be back in just a moment.
I've shown an interest in making home movies. Me and some buddies would just grab a camera and you just start making these videos, and then you realize at some point that this isn't just a hobby anymore, it's something that you actually want to pursue, and there's this great facility right down the road, BPTV. A lot of people will try to do these productions on their own, and one of the things they don't have is the equipment, you know, but right here is everything that you need in one nice little bundle. There's lights, cameras, reflectors, dollies, all kinds of little knickknacks, like anything that you'd want to use that you would need for a production, you have it right here. Like, it's all right here. You can make your own feature movie just with the stuff from this studio. Come meet Dave Cable, let him show you around, and I think you'll realize that this is something that you could fall into regardless of your level of expertise, whether you're a beginner or even if you're a more advanced learner. There's something here for everyone, and I feel that you just need to come through and just be a part of the experience and just watch and learn, and you know, let Dave be your guide.
Hi, everyone. We're back to The Neil Haley Show with Peter Elvich. Peter, I tell you, it's just, we have made it through this amazing thing. I want to thank BPTV for always these exciting interviews and fun stuff. And we talked to a lot of interesting people today. And I'm excited to welcome the program, Peter. Someone that you're going to really like talking with, Tony Quest. Tony, thanks for calling. You're an author and artist. Peter himself is an artist as well, Tony. I know you've been listening to some of the other interviews. Yeah, so you guys have something in common. So Tony, tell us a little bit about your latest book, but also we can chat a little bit about your art in the short period of time we have with you today.
Okay, cool. Thank you. Thank you for having me on the show. I really appreciate it. My latest book is Actualize, A Life in Progress. And it was published in 2014. On Christmas Eve morning, I'll say, and I'm really proud of this book, and I'm really happy I actually got it done. it's a life story, like a memoir. I think from the point of view of myself, the many angles as an artist, as a person, and also as a person that sort of reached an age that I guess it's one of those big numbers, you know?
Absolutely.
And it was written purely to inspire, you know? I guess if you read the book, you'll find that way, but people have been clamoring to me to write a book for a long time. And finally, I did it. I mean, I don't think there's anything real romantic about that part, but I do feel that it's candid. I feel it's very, sort of there's a nakedness about it that I felt compelled to present myself as I wrote this book.
I wonder, when, like, creating a book and then kind of having that artistic side as well, because this is something that I'm finding, is that I write about my own experiences at times. And I find that there are just times that you can't describe something in a word format that you actually have to put into a, more so of a visual or artistic format. At any time when you're creating the book, did you ever run into that where you're like, you know, I'm not sure how to put this in here, so maybe I'll create something visual, maybe as a compensation. It's just something I've always done, at least when I can't figure out how to say something, I would make a visual representation of how I feel instead.
Yeah, and I feel the same way. I just have learned, I guess, over the years that not everyone has the propensity to think abstractly. And I've sort of learned that most artists, I feel, at least for myself, much of my work is social commentary. And very often it's done from a point of view, and there's, even if it's representational, there's something abstract about its meaning. And in writing a book, which is sort of like taking the same person, the same mind, the same experience, and articulating it so maybe anyone can understand it and relate to it.
Wow.
If that makes sense.
Definitely. And how do you want to educate people in art, do you think, Tony? What is a mission for you for people to understand that are, you know, primarily visual artists, not as much the... you know, the other types of artists, the author, you're an author as well, but meaning author or filmmaker or certain thing. How do you want to, for that art genre?
In terms of my painting? In terms of my painting, I've just learned that it's really about metaphor. And a course that I teach, self-actualizing portraiture, I could have a student or students that are really, really astute in terms of presenting something that's representational could look like a photograph, but yet it doesn't really move you. And so I've taught how to find metaphors and inject them into the work. And so I think that as an artist, if you're working as an artist, one of the inability to think, I say, I hate to use the term both sides of the brain, which most people think are all right brain, but I think the truly genius artist in my experience has been one that can do that technical work and then also express the emotion. It's to bring the two things together that is a unique challenge for an artist.
Yes, definitely. Oh,
agreed.
I definitely agree with that. And it's something that they learn your passion, Tony, right? They're able to learn your passion from you, what you put out in art, right?
Yes, I think so, yeah. You know, and you know, I enjoy instructing others, and you know, I've worked in some challenging instructional situations teaching art, but I the biggest challenge has always been myself, you know, not being professionally trained and all. For the writing, I'll say, somehow that, once I get started, that just flows, you know, which I find interesting in itself, too. You know, you can write in an abstract way to do poetry, you know, and then again, you're definitely using metaphors. But I found that finding the metaphors in life, you know, and the metaphors in art, is something, there's some divinity to that. You know, it's sort of like a validation of things unseen.
Yeah, something you might find interesting too, that because I was taking a look and I did see that you do self-portraits. Something that you might find interesting is, like, currently I'm working on a piece of print here in the state of Minnesota. I already did one previously, but this one I'm doing completely non-visually because of my disability of blindness. And what I'm doing to kind of designate this self-portrait is I translate it into black and white for getting an idea of what the person's face looks like, and then analyzing it with colors based upon that, and then implementing my own aspects into it afterwards. But I just thought that would be an interesting thing to know about, that there is, you know, some artists out there that are doing actual self-portraits non-visually that you might find interesting.
I will. I know I will. And also, I'm wondering, are you able to discern light or nuances in light, even though you have a visual impairment? I'm really curious about that.
Yeah, I have a very low vision acuity, but I can still distinguish black and white and lightness. But as to my art, it's purely non-visual, using screen readers, RGB code, as well as photo analyzers. I create my art now completely non-visually, and I'm actually getting up to the scale where I was, where I'm making pieces that I do pixel art. So I do pieces square by square, pixel by pixel. And I used to do pieces that are 20,000 pixels to almost 4 million pixels, and I'm getting back up to that point where I'm creating these pieces again. So,
that's exciting.
Programs are being developed.
Yeah, it's amazing, Tony, to see his talent and how he's able to still, even though he's more and more going visually impaired, and he's been going through the health issues of losing his vision, that he's still able to be an artist. And it's a tremendous story.
I would like to hear more about that story for sure. You know, please send me your an email. I really love to hear, or something, because I'd love to hear more of that story.
For sure.
I was in a competition a few years ago. It might have been like 8-9 years ago, and it was for people with disabilities. And I was in it because of my diagnosis with multiple sclerosis. And I had visual impairment in one eye, and so I was asked to be in this. But the person who actually won the juried exhibition did such an amazing piece. And that person, they say, was blind, you know? And I'm like, wow. And I look at this beautiful piece. If I asked you about the light, they were able to capture light in a piece that they did, which was a night scene. It's just the most beautiful thing, one of the most beautiful things I've ever seen. That's why I asked you about the light. It's so fascinating how we compensate, you know?
Wow.
Yeah, really.
So, Tony, what's new with you? Updates on your books? Are you doing book signings in certain areas? What's new with the book?
Well, the book is really sort of taking a life of its own. I have done a couple of book signings. I've been one in Augusta, Georgia. I think it was in April, which was really exciting. And I will be doing another book signing here in Peekskill shortly. I'll be doing a book signing tomorrow because it's open studios in Peekskill, New York tomorrow, for tomorrow and Sunday. So I'll be doing a book signing at my own studio.
Wow.
So, as well as selling some art and lots of jewelry.
Yeah. So jewelry, another thing that you love, Tony?
Jewelry design is something that found me. Years ago, I think like 7 years ago, and it seems that people are asking for a lot of my jewelry designs, which isn't a surprise to me, but what I've done is decided to make it special, because I think there's a big market for people to be jewelers these days, for artists to make money in this. I've sort of made mine sort of specialized in a way, just to be a little more unique to capture a certain type of a market. I try to put symbolism in the jewelry that I do. It's a lot of symbols and things, you know. Just stop by, check out my website, streamingwoman.com.
Again, tell our listeners the website.
Definitely.
Again.
A streamingwoman.com,
although I don't like to raise my voice, but that is the title of my website.
That's you being a screaming woman in your art, not on, with your speaking, but through your art. So, Tony, thanks for calling, and take care, and thanks for coming on the show.
Oh, thank you for having me. I had a good time, and I want to talk more.
All right.
Thanks again. Have a really good day.
Take care, Tony. See ya. Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
All right. That was Tony Quest. And Peter, I guess a wrap-up. 1 minute I could say we made it through. We had some amazing guests, amazing themes, and it touched upon everything since you've known me and everything I have done to make this the Neil Haley Show. From Hollywood to special education to education to authors to entrepreneurship to business. We hit everything except professional wrestling.
Yeah,
but that's fine. I mentioned it. We will have it on again, trust me. Check me out, neilhaley.com. Push that like button if you're on YouTube. Hit comment. Tell us what you think, especially Bethel Park. Pick up the phone, call, tell us who you want to see on the show. Well, Peter, thanks again for calling. Take care. And it was great spending 3.5 hours of programming with you. So it kind of reminded me of those days of the Miami Book Fair. It's been awesome. Take care. And we'll talk soon, Peter. All right? Okay.
All right.
All right. Guys, that was the Neil Haley Show. The next time you'll see me, I hopefully will be tan. The next time you'll see me, hopefully it'll be a wonderful September with Coach Karen Hall. So take care. Thanks for supporting the Neil Haley Show, and we'll see you next week. Take care, everyone.
I think film and television in general is a very discouraging industry. It takes a lot of years of pounding the pavement, calling people, finding your ends. You're gonna carry a lot of heavy cable, get dirty a lot, and find your way in. With the limited amount of resources out there and the limited amount of opportunities, there's a fantastic resource right here. And it's public access, it's free of charge. Anybody can come in and gain that experience. Dave absolutely loves to help people, you know, never said no to us growing up. Anything we wanted to do, we were able to do here. The first year I was here, I would just sign on for different projects, like Stump the Students was a show that I worked on quite frequently. It was a game show. We would just come up with our own little ideas, mostly sketches, a lot of school projects, a lot of classes when we'd have to do a project on a story we read or something like that. I would always ask if we could do a video as our project instead, and we would typically do it through Dave. You know, one of my favorite things we did was one of the simplest things we did. It was put together in an afternoon. It was something we wanted to do for fun. We were playing around learning Final Cut Pro, learning how to do linear editing, and we decided to do something in reverse. So we filmed me, actually, I think it was, running around the building out here, jumping off walls backwards, running around backwards, and played the whole thing in reverse. It was really simple. It was, you know, corny. We just did it for fun, but for a couple weeks after that, people kept coming up to me at school like, well, how'd you do that? We were more exposed to our student body than we felt we were, not having an association with any extracurriculars of the school. It was fun to see how, even though we were doing it on our own, it was still making its reach to Bethel Park, and it was still something that we were getting feedback for, positive feedback from, and that was really nice. I would say that BPTV is one of the greatest creative resources this community has, and I would absolutely encourage anyone with any interest in production to come here and learn from Dave and take their ideas and turn them into something. If I hadn't been here at BPTV, I wouldn't have advanced at the rate I did in my industry. I wouldn't have had the passion for my industry nurtured the way it was here. I don't think that I would have pursued it because I don't think I would have had as clear a picture of what was available to me in this industry unless I had come here and gotten that first-hand experience prior to having to make the decisions that you have to make whenever you're graduating from high school. Opportunity really only comes to people who establish a lifestyle to seize it. And this is the kind of place where you can seize an opportunity and change